The James Webb Space Telescope costed an enormous $10 billion. Over its 20 years of development, it was delayed and rescheduled so many times that its original launch plan for 2007 didn't happen until December 2021. Massive science projects like JWST have the unique challenge of convincing the average taxpayer or politician, who might not know which end of a telescope to look into, that the expense is worth it. Webb observes wavelengths of light from visible orange to mid-infrared, which makes it pretty versatile, and it's the most powerful space telescope that we've ever made. It has potential to make major breakthroughs in cosmology and the search for exoplanets and solar system science, so if we want to build an argument for spending more money on astronomy in the future, we really want a lot of astronomers from a lot of different fields to be able to use the observatory. And it's not just about money. The telescope isn't going to work forever, so we need to make all the discoveries we can before it's too late. Astronomers from all over the world are submitting proposals for what they want Webb to look at, and naturally, they're all in different parts of the sky. If you have a list of hundreds of stars all over the sky, then how do you plan your telescope's schedule so that it observes each one while traveling the smallest amount, saving you precious time and fuel? This problem isn't unique to astronomy. It shows up when a driver is making deliveries, when a factory robot drills holes in a circuit board, and even when pigeons grab food from feeders. In this video, we'll learn why this problem is so hard and what we can do to solve it. And we'll learn how the engineering of the Webb telescope actually changes the answer. The problem we're interested in is most commonly called the traveling salesman problem, because it's usually presented with cities instead of stars, and a salesperson who needs to visit all the cities as fast as possible, instead of a telescope. At first glance, this might not seem very difficult. You just visit whichever city is closest to you, and you haven't visited yet. That's not too bad. But what if your map looks like this? By going only to the closest city and never thinking ahead, you can get yourself caught in situations like this that increase the total length of your trip. And it's impossible to know how many cities ahead you need to look. For some routes, there are tricks you can use to say that it's too long without calculating the whole distance, but still, the only way to guarantee that you found the shortest possible trip is to check every single possible route. So, how many is that? Well, if you have n cities, then you have n options for your first visit. After that, you can think of the remaining cities as their own map, so the number of routes to check is n times however many routes there are with n minus 1 cities. But we just figured that out, so we can plug it into itself, and then again, and again, until we get to 1, and with 1 city, we have only 1 possible route. So for a map with n cities, there are n factorial routes that we need to check to find the fastest one. I get the feeling that most people don't appreciate how astronomically big factorials are. Let's say that you're handing out cookies at a party with 20 friends all standing around in a room, and you want to solve this problem so that you don't walk more than you need to. We'll say your mental math is amazing, so it only takes you 1 second to calculate the total distance for any route between those 20 friends. 20 factorial equals 20 times 19 times 18 times blah 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 times 2 times 1, which equals 2.43 times 10 to the power of 18. It would take you 2 quintillion seconds to figure it out, aka 77 billion years, aka the entire age of the universe, times 6. Your friends wouldn't have the patience for that. But that can't be right. Humans don't just overheat and cease to function every time we're asked to pass out snacks. We just pass them out without thinking, and we do a pretty good job of it, too. In fact, a lot of animals do. Pigeons, for example, are able to find efficient routes when they're presented with feeders that they can visit one time each. So what kinds of computations are happening in our heads to find these solutions? And how could we program a computer to find these solutions? The most direct answer is that we don't find the best route, we just find one that's really good. Computer scientists have come up with all kinds of ways of quickly finding a route that's fast enough. In fact, the one I mentioned earlier does work. Always visit the closest city to you that hasn't been visited yet. In many cases, this does a good job. But it would be better if we had a way to get unstuck from these situations. For example, you might notice that every time a route crosses over another, we can make the path shorter by swapping the destination cities. So once we have a rough idea of the route, we can go through and swap all the paths that cross each other. In fact, with this method, we don't even need to start by making a route with the closest city method. We could just generate a random route, and then optimize it by swapping paths until there are no crosses left. Still, this won't get us the best possible route, but it does a pretty decent job. With the traveling salesman or with any optimization problem, you can imagine a function that takes in any possible solution as the input, and then the output is some way of measuring how bad it is. In our case, this would be the total distance traveled. You'll get all these hills and valleys of varying depths, and our goal is to find the global minimum. This is the absolute optimal solution. But what complicates that is all of these local minima. If you just start with some solution and always try to make it better, then you'll get caught in one of these small valleys because you can't see the bigger one right over these hills that surround it. The best optimization algorithms have ways of exploring past these hills. For the traveling salesman problem, this could be done by simulating ants following scent trails, simulating electron spins in a ferromagnet, simulating a metal being annealed to remove impurities. Nature's already figured out ways to cross these hills, so sometimes it's easiest just to use code that's already written for us. Let's get back to the original reason this problem came up, the Webb telescope. You might imagine a satellite in space rotating itself by activating thrusters, but for fine changes, the JWST actually has a more clever system that uses reaction wheels. By changing the speed of these weighted wheels, conservation of angular momentum requires the satellite to rotate in the opposite direction. So if we make three wheels, one for each axis, and keep them spinning, then we can point the telescope at any angle by temporarily slowing some of them down. Webb actually has six for redundancy. The beautiful thing about this system is that the motors are solar-powered, so unlike rotating the telescope with thruster fuel, everything is renewable, and in space, where there are no outside forces, the telescope can theoretically run forever. But there are outside forces. To keep the observatory's instruments cool, Webb has a tennis court-sized heat shield that faces the sun. You might even say it looks like a sail, and unintentionally, that's exactly what it is. Photons might not have mass, but they have momentum, so sunlight is constantly pushing on JWST and rotating it. At first, that's not a problem, because we can correct the telescope by spinning the reaction wheels faster. But the wheels do have a maximum speed where they'll break, so once they reach that point, we need to turn on the thrusters to dump the stored momentum. That way, we can slow down the wheels and the telescope stays in place and doesn't start spinning. Having to use fuel regularly like this puts a finite limit on the telescope's lifespan. So if we think in terms of fuel usage, planning observations is not at all like the traveling salesman problem. Instead of planning our schedule so the telescope moves as little as possible, we need to plan our schedule so momentum builds up as little as possible. That means that we want to schedule observations next to each other that cancel each other out. Move one direction, then move the other. Move a little that way, then move a little back. The closer we stay to a net angular momentum change of zero, the fewer times we need to use our thrusters. But if we think in terms of downtime, planning observations is exactly the traveling salesman problem. We still want scientists to get their data as soon as possible, so we want to look at stars in a time-efficient way. In many cases, this directly contradicts the fuel requirement. We now have a problem in what we call multi-objective optimization. Making one variable better makes the other worse. Before, our goal was to find the global minimum of travel distance, but now the global minimum of travel distance and the global minimum of fuel usage might not coincide at all. When we plot all the solutions to a multi-objective problem, in our case, all the possible observation schedules, we typically get something like this. The solutions stop near the corner because you just can't have the best of both worlds. These solutions along the boundary are what we call the Pareto front. They represent the solutions that are as good as they can get. Once we reach this line, any improvement in one variable makes the other worse. When it comes down to it, there's really no computer algorithm that can decide what solution is best, we just know it's probably going to be on this boundary. So all we can do is write a program that uses optimization algorithms to find the set of solutions, then give it to a committee of humans to decide whether it's best to save fuel and possibly lengthen the mission, or to give more scientists observation time sooner. Optimization problems are ubiquitous in today's technology, especially with all the attention that we've been giving to machine learning. And we sometimes get caught in the stream that they're going to solve every problem we could possibly encounter. curing diseases, translating languages, discovering new laws of physics, recommending the perfect video. And don't get me wrong, optimization algorithms have helped make unprecedented progress in all these fields. But even with machine assistance, we still need to stay healthy, and be culturally aware, and understand the physics, and decide what videos are worth our time. See, the universe has already done all the math for us. Matter is finding the answers to optimization problems all the time just by following the laws of physics, not by thinking about it. Computers are just our way of tricking the universe into giving us those answers. But in order to do that, we need to know what questions to ask. We need to know the specific variable that we're minimizing or maximizing. And sometimes that's not that easy to figure out, but we're always better off when we understand the problem.